What do psychedelics have to do with drug policy reform? We have a very distinguished panel. And so what I'd like to do first is to introduce each of our panelists and ask them to take 2 minutes, and I have been instructed by not just JAG, but higher powers to keep people's remarks at somewhere around 2 minutes, especially the intro, and then the other question and questions take a little bit longer. So we're going to start with intros and then move on to the general question, which I think is fascinating. And obviously you do too, which is why you're straggling into the room. What do psychedelics have to do with drug policy reform? What do they have to do with our general mission? So let me start off with, how do I do a small intro on this person? A virtual, literal encyclopedia. My co-author, Jerome B. Beck. Okay, take 2 minutes, Jerry, and say who you are.
I'm Jerry Beck, and I started, like probably a lot of people, in high school, totally clueless, sampling some of these different psychedelics, like LSD and shrooms. Went to University of Oregon and began working at the University of Oregon Drug Information Center. This is in the late 70s. At a time during the Carter administration of kind of an era of tolerance where the government policy was really seemed to be shifting for a precious short period of time to where there was a just say K-N-O-W, for lack of a better term. Responsible drug use education was a term that was accepted by NIDA and promoted. And we were one of many organizations, often starting on campuses, such as Do It Now, Wisconsin Clearinghouse, Stash, Upfront in Miami. All of us, for the most part, closed during the Reagan early 80s, the beginning of the drug war, where we went into this shift into kind of the currently still dominant, just say NO policy. With no use dictates, preventing any type of prevention education research that's federally funded. And it's really put a chill on dissemination of information. With my 30 seconds left, I'm sure. After the Drug Information Center, I came down to Berkeley, and where I did research with Marsha, ended up meeting many other interesting people, such as Rick. Marsha and I were on the first federally funded sociological study of MDMA, which was, going back to the language of the last panel, we had a lot of negative things we were looking for, and we were. We were trying to be open to everything, but we also, like many other studies done by research around the country, we're looking at the positive as well. We just did not put that into the proposal, expect that to be funded. And I've been following it ever since, and most recently I've kind of joined up with Rick again with MAPS funded study of the veterans study, the Midhofers in South Carolina, adding a qualitative element to that. That would be the other thing is I should mention is that I specialize in qualitative research, and so we're starting to look at PTSD and MDMA from a qualitative perspective as well as from the usual clinical perspective. So I'll leave it at that.
Okay. Next is Jacob Sullum.
Hi. I've been writing about drug policy for 20-something years. I actually got sort of got interested, my whole career kind of grows out of altered states of consciousness, in a sense, because I've been interested in those for as long as I can remember. I wrote a paper, I think it was like eighth or ninth grade, about sensory deprivation tanks and how they illustrated, you know, the impact of expectations on the experience that, you know, that people have, in this case, using deprivation tanks, but obviously it extends to drugs as well. You know, the short of it was when people expected it to be horrible, it was horrible. You know, when they approached it as a form of torture, they had uniformly negative experiences, but when they saw it as a way of you know, opening up their minds and thinking new and interesting thoughts and having visions, they were much more likely to have positive experiences. And so that's always sort of fascinated me, and it's been an aspect of drug use that applies especially, you know, to psychedelics. Something that the policymakers don't seem to quite get, that, you know, drugs don't cause people to do anything or feel anything or see anything in any kind of mechanistic way, but there are all of these other variables that enter into it. So that's been interesting to me for a long time, and I think in the current debate, as we see marijuana being legalized, it would be very interesting to see what happens with psychedelics. We can get into that later, but I think there's some interesting opportunities there in terms of psychedelics.
Next is my old friend, Rick Doblin.
Well, all of this sort of what I'm doing with my life, it all came together when I was 18. And I first did LSD, and I was also a draft resistor. So my fundamental identity was as a counterculture drug using criminal. And ever since, I've been trying to go straight. Because I don't really want to be a counterculture criminal. And so the arc of my life is that I've eventually managed to get an undergraduate degree in psychology, trained by Stan Grof in the holotropic breathwork, the world's leading LSD researcher, found a non-drug approach through hyperventilation to talk about the therapeutic use of all non-ordinary states. And then I was blocked in, Debbie introduced me to MDMA in 1982. When it was still legal. So I felt like I woke up to LSD just as it was shut down, but I was becoming aware of MDMA when it was clear that the crackdown was coming, but it hadn't come yet. So that's where I started focusing on politics and trying to protect the community of psychotherapists that was using these drugs and the people that were using them, and develop a whole network of experts that would then testify for us in the upcoming DEA trial. And because politics kept blocking the research, I decided to study politics. So that's where I went to the Kennedy School of Government, got my master's and PhD from that. And I felt like when the crackdown came on MDMA, that the only way out was through the FDA to make it back into a prescription medicine. So basically what I'm doing now is running a nonprofit pharmaceutical company trying to develop psychedelics and marijuana into prescription medicines. And I'll just say that the psychedelics touch on areas of religious freedom, human rights, more so than a lot of the other drugs that we're talking about that also need to have policy shifts. But the psychedelics give us unique opportunities in the drug policy world to raise certain kind of arguments.
Next, Jim Fadiman.
I'll just take up from where Rick left off. I began my career just before graduate school, finding out that psychology was going to be worthless, and then I got a degree in it. And I was right. And did a dissertation on the effectiveness of LSD therapy, which was about to be submitted to publication when the government said, no, there are no possible good uses, and all the journals have been so informed. So I had a different career, and I'm back, and LSD is back, and research is back, and psychedelics are back. And the issue of the question, I don't know if you were there this morning, but this is a fight for freedom and justice and equality. I'll kind of let the rest of you handle justice and equality, but I think there are some very basic freedoms, which Rick just referred to, and it seems to me it's a basic human right to be able to understand yourself. I don't think that is something that the government has the audacity to take away. I also think, given the way the world is, that we have a basic human right to understand the world, to study it, to observe it, to learn about it. Science is one of the major ways. It feels to me it is a basic human right to be able to pursue science, to be able to pursue understanding of the universe, of the world. And I think it is a basic human right to be able to be closer to divinity. I don't think that is, again, one of the jobs of government is to prevent that. And so in those areas, it seems to me that the policy issues are much more profound and that we should be very, very careful not to be saying, let's do this a drug at a time, because that's missing these deeper points. And I think certainly, in a sense, as marijuana is clearly going in the right direction and it will take a certain amount of time. We're next. And I think one of the things that I finally admitted is marijuana, for many people, is a gateway drug. It happens to be a gateway drug to what we're interested in.
Next, from Canada, Philippe Lucas.
Thank you, Marsha. I'm a graduate researcher with the Center for Addictions Research in British Columbia, and the focus of my research over the last 10 years has been therapeutic applications for cannabis and for psychedelics. And I originally got involved in psychedelic research through MAPS, helping out with an ibogaine, an addiction study, and most recently completed an ayahuasca-assisted treatment study to look at ayahuasca as a treatment for addiction and trauma. I'll be doing a presentation on that tomorrow at 2:30, and I hope some of you will come out to see that. It was a totally fascinating experience. I'm board chair of MAPS Canada, and really for me, psychedelics became more important in my life in 1995 when I quit drinking, and that really deepened my relationship with psychedelics. I was diagnosed with Hep C, and so alcohol, which was my drug of choice, ended up leaving my life, and I had to find other means of expression and other tools for social engagement. And I found psychedelics to be really powerful plant teachers. They really have improved my opportunities in the search for self, as Jim mentioned. And I think as we get older, they also provide a rare opportunity for novelty, which is more and more challenging as we get through life. It's not all serious and spiritual, however. I'm a raver for life, and I'm pretty sure that trap music's going to save the world. So there's also a fun aspect to psychedelics that we can't forget as well. So I'll look forward to this discussion. It's great to be on this panel.
Thank you all, and I thought I should tell you why I'm up here, why Jag probably asked me. So my interest in psychedelics, I think, began at, when I was a researcher for the National Institute on Drug Abuse, studying heroin addiction and methadone maintenance and such. And just about at that point, there was this drug that appeared on the cover of Time magazine. What is this drug called? Ecstasy. Interesting, to say the least. And so at that point, the government didn't really know anything about it, at least sociologically. And so we put in a grant proposal. Jerry and I were working together already on a methadone study. We put in a grant proposal saying the usual stuff that you say in a grant proposal, which is, there is this new drug and we have no idea what's going to happen. Somebody's got to look at this. And that was the most fortunate grant award ever. And so we did this research, and I want to acknowledge Debbie Harlow, who's in the audience, who was with us doing this research, who at this time we started the research made a remark that I will never forget. Which was, well, you know, with MDMA, you only get 10 good trips. I said, Debbie, really? And so I still remember that. So I hadn't realized that.
Is that true?
You can consult her later on that one before we talk to each other. I hadn't realized we were all going to do true confessions. So let's move on to the question, the main question at hand. What do psychedelics have to do with drug policy reform? So I'd like to ask each of you, in whatever order you want to go in, to take 2-3 minutes to elaborate on this general question. What do psychedelics have to do with drug policy reform?
Thanks. I'm going to start out by problematizing this a bit. I'm going to reverse it. I'm going to say, what does the war on drugs have to do with psychedelics? I want to clarify that I'm a full-on legalizer. I believe that all of the currently illicit substances should be legalized and accessible in one form or another. But when you look at some of the other illicit substances, you can pick out very clearly the potential for physical harm, the potential for addictiveness that simply doesn't exist with the traditional psychedelics. Whether I think it can be argued that there might be a risk of OD with MDMA in seriously high doses. But when we're talking about LSD, psilocybin, and certainly substances like ayahuasca, I think that the risk is so minimal that you have to ask, what is the interest of our government in attacking these substances and demonizing them and as making them illegal? And I would suggest that making these substances illegal is really akin to book burning. People who burn books, when we see movies or you see the old day, you know, whether it be Nazi propaganda or otherwise, when people gather together to burn books, those people don't hate bindings and pages and paper and words. The reason that people burn books is because they fear the ideas that are contained in those books. And it's hard to look at the ban on psychedelics when you know and understand the potential for the good that psychedelics can do personally, certainly socially as well, without looking at them in a very similar way. I think the only way that I can grasp this is to see that the ban on psychedelics is a serious but symbolic attack on cognitive freedom and liberties. And that is why I think we need to be very concerned about this. This isn't about public harm. This isn't about, you can't point to the dangers and harms of psilocybin. There just isn't a study out there that suggests that it's a rampage through North America despite their availability. So I think that we need to look further than that, and we need to really challenge the fact that people are trying to affect what we're allowed and control what we're allowed to think and how we're allowed to think it. And yeah, so I say let's reverse the question. Why psychedelics? Why are they part of this ban on other this prohibition on certain substances?
Well, the danger one is wonderful, and many of you know the marijuana danger. And actually, we now have one death from marijuana, which is great for those of us who talk about it, because the next thing on the chart, I don't know if you've seen that wonderful chart, top of it is tobacco, 400,000 deaths a year, and you kind of go down the chart, and marijuana's on the bottom, and it used to be zero, but now it's one, so that the next one up is 10,000 times worse, which is peanuts.
Peanuts.
100 deaths a year.
Jim, somebody else must be wondering.
Oh, yes, a bale of marijuana fell on someone. I love it. Yeah, it is a danger, which doesn't happen with LSD. So that's part of it, and I really love this way of beginning to reframe it as cognitive freedom, as personal liberty, as the right to know know God. See, I love to get on right-wing shows so I can do this. And because there's no argument. And that is the issue. The issue really is very much as framed, which is, how did we ever get in there in the first place? And the answer actually is about public policy, and it's about fueling the disregard or the disinterest or the kind of waking up about the failure of major institutions in the culture. And whether the establishment is, I sent a book proposal once to the East Coast and it was refused. And I asked Jeremy Tarcher why. It was a novel about psychedelics. He said the East Coast never liked psychedelics. Because imagine, what happened is, you know, your kid is in college and you're a banker and maybe you're even a decent banker in the 60s. And your kid comes home and says, everything you do sucks. And you say, I'm paying $18,000 a year for you to go to Yale to do that. He says, and that sucks too. So it got banned for cognitive reasons. It got banned for emotional reasons. It got banned for fear of change reasons. And it has remained banned pretty much for the same. Those reasons have not changed too much.
I don't know how many of you here are NIDA researchers, but one of the most reliable indicators of drug use trends that has been consistent over the last 40 years or so is this relationship between perceived risk of a drug and the abuse of that drug, whereas abuse is defined as use. So as the perceived risk goes up, they'll see declines in the abuse use of this drug. That's the most reliable relationship about social trends that NIDA has developed in all of their time trying to study these things. So what the first thing to say is that it's the perception of risk, it's not the real risk. So what that does is it impacts how drug education is done. So the most important challenge, I think, to drug policy and why psychedelics have such a major role to play in drug policy reform is that many people have really positive experiences with these drugs, life-changing experiences that they're really willing to talk about, and that gets in the way of this sense of drugs as causing harm. Not a lot of people will, although Carl Hart before was talking about benefits of methamphetamine that he was finding, but you find that most people are willing to talk more about benefits that they've gotten from psychedelics than from a lot of the other classes of drugs. So it directly calls into question this whole idea of how do we keep promoting the risks of these drugs, particularly when we start talking about medical research. So I think it's the whole question is, do we have honest drug education or do we have fear-based education designed to scare people away from doing drugs? So that's the big challenge that psychedelics offered a drug education in a drug prohibition world. The other big issue is scientific freedom. Do we have the right, not even necessarily to say to use these things for our own purposes, but do we have the right for scientists to study how well these drugs, what their risks and benefits are? So we've had a complete global prohibition for 20 years on psychedelic research that had nothing to do with risks and benefits of the drugs. It had a lot to do with the risks and benefits of the information that came from the studies. So it raises this whole question about scientific freedom. We also have this big issue, and I think that's where the drug war is sort of coalescing around now, is parents worried about their kids and protecting the kids. Because psychedelics are used for rites of passage. They're used very disproportionately by people who are in their teens and early 20s. As they're trying to figure out who they are, what they're going to do with their life, where they're going to go party, you know, what, so that it's something that a lot of people tend to give up as they get older, not because they necessarily thought it was harmful, but just that they get busy with other things. So psychedelics really raise this whole issue about how we deal with kids and drugs. And if we look at the cultures that have successfully integrated drugs, the ones that have integrated ayahuasca and peyote, they don't have age limits. They have parental supervision in religious rituals where people get little, kids get little amounts. Then the other part that psychedelics have to play in the drug policy debate is about harm reduction. So we normally think of harm reduction as needle exchange or some other kind of methods to help sort of hard drug users. But with all the concerns that we've had recently about Molly and about impure Molly and people dying at electronic dance festivals, we started a policy for the last 10 years where we're trying to bring harm reduction, psychedelic harm reduction, more offered at festivals. And by that we mean two things. The people that have intended to have just fun, the psychedelics bring out more serious issues, and then they have difficult psychedelic experiences that could turn into a bad trip, could turn into a trip to the police, trip to the hospital, and we were able to show that if you give compassionate care and help people work through their stuck spots, that a lot of times they can gain from it. So the psychedelic harm reduction and our Zendo project, which Lene is coordinating, and which we've gone to festivals around the world, it's a big project to try to get the whole idea of harm reduction through the drug policy. And then the other part really is this religious and personal freedom. Psychedelics really bring that to the fore. So I think that there are so many ways that psychedelics impact, and I think for many of us, for me and others, motivated by positive psychedelic experiences to say, how can these be against the law? How can all these other drugs be against the law? It just doesn't make sense. So I think that we have a lot of people with profound, deep personal experiences that have been then motivated, and a lot of the people involved in drug policy reform have had those experiences. Students for a Sensible Drug Policy, their students on college campuses are just very interested in psychedelics. So I think there's just a natural way where psychedelics can help expand drug policy reform efforts.
building on all these excellent comments. I first started coming to the Drug Policy Alliance when it had earlier incarnations of their name. I think the first one was in 1988. Speaking on the subject, I was in the midst of our MDMA study at that time. But there was, just as now, a lot of the same common concerns around psychedelic casualties of the drug war and of the war on truth, which is really the, I think, the largest take-home message I've brought back from those first couple of conferences here, was all of different variations on the war on truth being the first casualty of a drug, of the drug war, the ongoing drug war. And at that time, I mean, there was, Rick was mentioning our recent Molly, all of the media blitz, and the misinformation that is kind of like a flashback from things reported on back in the late 80s, designer drug confusion. At that time, the concerns around the fentanyl analogs and around MPPP, surfaced, that we had designer drug legislation, which attempted to control anything that looked like a controlled substance. And that was wrapped up a lot in rhetoric, both by the government and particularly by the media, which would often confuse MDMA and MPPP. So MDMA was alleged to cause Parkinson's, and that was became a common belief among a lot of people that were introduced to it. And it echoed a lot of these earlier myths that started after LSD was criminalized. And not only did we have the therapeutic research that had been very promising on LSD and other psychedelic drugs, an incredible amount of studies that was becoming a mature field, stopped in its tracks by the original Controlled Substances Act and other state and federal legislation. In a sense, it introduced a lot of the mythology into our culture, and what we have, that we still suffer from, is kind of coming back to what Rick was saying, the head of the Monitoring the Future Survey, is kind of coined the phrase generational forgetting, where new generations discover these or rediscover these drugs without knowing about all the old facts, let's call them that, from before. But in a sense, the generational forgetting is happening primarily at a different level than just the users. Let me stop and just mention some of the positive developments I see now, because I think we did have the demise of a lot of good drug education was starting to develop in the later 60s and particularly throughout the 70s. And we still kind of suffer from this combination of just say no all the way to the dictates of the federal government, but particularly from just say nothing, that at the high school level and colleges, most likely students are getting no real education, honest education at all. About substances, let alone people after high school or college. As we age in life, I guess direct-to-consumer commercials are our main form of education. But the positive things that I see, they're really, I think, indicative of where we're going, hopefully, are what's happening overseas with a lot of the harm reduction efforts, informational efforts that are happening in Europe, Australia, the policy changes in New Zealand. And then here on the home front, the work of Erwid and other organizations to enlighten increasingly the LinkedIn generation. And then the work of DanceSafe and Zenda in doing concert medicine. I used to do rock medicine with the Grateful Dead concerts. And in a sense, this is even a much more advanced, sophisticated way of reaching a population that does a lot of good.
Um, I guess my fear, well, first of all, I'm totally surprised by how quickly we're making progress with marijuana. Not expected at all. I thought by the time I died, maybe, you know, but that would, it would happen, you know, within the next decade, I did not believe. So I'm excited about that. But I think there's a risk that marijuana will become legal because it's familiar. And because if you look at the survey data, assuming there's a certain amount of underreporting, which there almost certainly is, that people don't want to admit that they've broken the law, most people born after World War II have used marijuana. So it is, in that sense, a majority drug. And you know, the history of drug policy is of other people's drugs being banned. So my fear is that drugs that appeal to a minority taste, which psychedelics always have, never been a majority taste, will sort of fall by the wayside, and people will say, that's not my cup of tea. Even if they're not that afraid of it, there won't be a constituency, or enough of a constituency, for legalizing these other substances, because they're exotic and they're unfamiliar, and most people don't care for them. Really, it's a matter of taste, in that sense. There are a couple of opportunities to overcome that, both of which we've alluded to, at least. One of which is a sort of medical exception. And Rick, in many ways, is working on exactly that. the idea that certain psychedelics are useful in treatment, generally in treatment of certain psychiatric disorders, and may very well be, and get approved for that purpose. So they will be much like other prescription drugs, but you still have to get official permission to use them, right? So that. Unless you are blessed with a psychiatric diagnosis and a prescription, you have the special permission, you can't use it. Even if using that drug might, in fact, improve your life. Unless somebody can get an MD to say that that's okay, you're not allowed to do it. So it's certainly better that some people have access to legal access than none, but it's still troubling that you need, you know, sort of special permission. And the other avenue is religious exception, which we have to some extent already. The Native American Church has long been permitted to use peyote under the Religious Freedom Restoration Act, as interpreted by the Supreme Court in a unanimous decision. American followers of these South American religions that use ayahuasca, if their church is approved as a real church, you know, this is a problem, one of the problems, they're allowed to do it. They're allowed to use that. This is by statute. This is a statute that conservatives overwhelmingly supported in Congress, because they were alarmed by the idea that certain government policies that created burdens for religion would no longer be overturned by the Supreme Court, because the Supreme Court, I won't get into that, but they basically changed their approach to religious freedom cases such that as long as you had a law with a secular rationale, that was generally applicable, that was not targeting people based on their religion, it was okay, even if it basically made it impossible for you to practice your religion. So you could ban somebody's sacrament under this new approach to the First Amendment and make their religion impossible to practice, but as long as you were doing it for reasons other than persecuting them, that was okay. So that people got very upset about that. Like I said, it was very overwhelmingly supported in Congress to restore the status quo ante in terms of the doctrine, the approach to religious freedom. So that was encouraging. But again, you have to get official approval. And who gets official approval? Well, it helps if the drug makes you vomit. That really seems, that helps a lot. So start from get a drug that makes you vomit. If it doesn't naturally make you vomit, you should mix in some Ipecac or something to make it unpleasant, to make it an arduous ordeal. Because, all right, now it's not frivolous, right? Because you gotta go through this thing that's quite unpleasant before you come out the other end and you get some kind of vision. So that definitely helps. It also helps if it's a very tiny religion, not many followers. Crucially, if the drug that happens to be your sacrament does not appeal to people in general for recreational use. Why is it Rastafarians have never gotten permission to use pot? Because so many other people like to smoke pot. The only reason. And then what they'll say is, oh, we're really worried about diversion. And that's what that means. That this is, here is a drug that's very appealing to the general public as a recreational intoxicant. You're never going to get permission to use this on religious grounds. So it's totally arbitrary. And if you look at these decisions dealing with, you know, religious freedom cases, who gets permission to use a certain drug because their religion commands it, or because it's involved in one of their central rights, and who doesn't, it's totally arbitrary. And you have judges probing people's beliefs,
I mean, I thought the government wasn't supposed to do this, right? I mean, under the First Amendment, you wouldn't think the government gets to say what's a legitimate religion, what's not a legitimate religion. But that is absolutely what judges are doing when they say, is this guy for real? Well, first of all, is he for real in the sense, is he sincere, right? Because maybe this guy just wants to smoke pot. That's the natural inclination. But beyond that, even if he is sincere, they're going to say, well, is this really a religion? It sounds like crap shit to me, you know? You really believe that? These stories are kind of nonsensical. It's not very coherent. It's like, obviously, you can take anybody's religion and try to attack it on that basis. So it's utterly arbitrary. And I would just close by pointing out that during alcohol prohibition, throughout alcohol prohibition, there was a religious exception, there was a medical exception. Okay, so it's not doesn't get you really as far as you want to go. That was considered an utter disaster, even though people were always allowed to use alcohol for religious purposes and purposes and medical purposes under prohibition.
So I'm going to make up a couple of questions here. The notion of harm reduction was mentioned, I think by Jerry or Rick. So what is, I understand harm reduction when it comes to needles, that kind of thing. What does harm reduction look like when it comes to psychedelics?
Well, I'll just start out by talking about the world's best example of psychedelic harm reduction at a festival, which is at the Boom Festival in Portugal. And the first thing to say is that drugs are decriminalized in Portugal. And what that does is it permits on-site thin layer chromatography. So what they do at this festival is they have all the dealers know that their drugs are going to be tested, and the what's in them and what the contaminants are in them are going to be promoted to everybody else at the festival. So that's the same that you get in a way when a drug is medical. Supposedly, you know, the FDA makes sure that what it says it is, it really is that. So we have more about drug purity. Then what they've been able to do at these at Boom is to recognize that there are a lot of people that do experiment with psychedelics that get into difficult areas. Even if you are, you know, a perfectly healthy person, it's not just people with clinical conditions. Everybody who's you know, had anxiety reaction to pot or has had psychedelic psychotherapy, there's parts that it's really scary and difficult. So it's not just, you know, it's everybody has difficult parts. So that when you get into these spaces, if you can have support, then you can make a lot of progress. The alternative often is that people get to the attention of the medical authorities and then they get tranquilized and sent off to a hospital or to the police. And the tranquilization sort of freezes the psychic contents in place, and you get the message that you can't really handle them. So we need to avoid at all costs tranquilizing people. So psychedelic harm reduction permits that alternative approach. And at the same time, what it does is that people, when this kind of facilities are out in the open, a lot of people come by who are not necessarily having a difficult time. They're tripping, but they sort of want to have a place to congregate, a place to talk to people, so that you can sort of help avoid things turning difficult. And they have special areas, chill-out areas, where people rest after tripping, and they provide free water throughout it, so that you can have events where the risk is really managed in a very successful way. Not to say that there are no risks or that there won't be difficulties, but risk is part of life. There's no way to avoid risk. Every drug contains a certain amount of risk. But psychedelic harm reduction really is sort of the flip side of benefit maximization. So that by teaching people how to deal with difficult trips, you're also teaching them on their own how to get the most benefit out of these experiences. So we're able to teach therapeutic principles in the context of harm reduction. So it's a vehicle for education that we might not otherwise be able to do.
For those who don't go to festivals, or smaller festivals that don't have this advantage, information really helps. And that's part of what I'm interested in. There's a free site called entheoguides.net, which teaches people how to have safe and beneficial sessions with classic psychedelics. And that happens to be very important because set and setting is still, even though we talk about it all the time, it's still underplayed in the literature, and still underplayed even when we talk. We still talk about psychedelics. We don't talk about psychedelic experiences. And Roland Griffiths did a big international questionnaire on the web and got a couple of thousand people who'd had bad trips. Then he asked a question, which is, was it beneficial? About 80% of the people who'd had, quote, bad trips said, yes, it was extremely beneficial. So there's a lot we don't know. And just a couple of fact checks that marijuana is, that LSD is a minority drug. It is a minority drug. Only 25 million Americans have used it since it became illegal. Now, also, those 25 million Americans tend to be clustered in the more educated part of our culture. Now, let me just show you something. How many of you have not used a psychedelic? Okay, there's one person in the back who would like something. That's something just to notice, okay? So the question that Rick was saying earlier, what does it have to do with drug reform? Well, I'm not going to push on that, but it's obvious that it's linked to drug reformers. And one other item, which was from, I think, was yours, which is the notion of this generational forbidding, was that the term?
Generational forgetting, yes.
Yeah. I just was talking with 300 students at UC Santa Cruz one evening, and I asked them, as I did you, but I asked them about, you know, major uses, and they said, about 90% of them who were 95, there actually were two kids who hadn't used psychedelics, and they were there getting credit. Looking very, very scared. And then I had just a moment, I said, how many of your parents use psychedelics? About 85%. So in the 40 years where we didn't know anything or say anything and 24 million Americans were taking it, we now have two generations of psychedelic using people. And so that's something which I have not really seen anywhere else, except that is what's going on. And so we have something else to look at in terms of harm reduction, fear reduction, and of course the big one, stupidity reduction.
Pretty good. I completely agree with what's been said so far. I had a chance to volunteer at the Zendo at Burning Man a couple of years ago with Lene, and I highly recommend it if you guys are interested in psychedelic harm reduction. It's a great way to see Burning Man and to help out and participate and give back. I want to flip it around a little bit by talking about psychedelics as harm reduction. I think the thing that we forget sometimes, and certainly that I've learned in working in psychedelics as a treatment for trauma and addiction, is that there are far more dangerous and challenging substances out there that people often develop a dependence to. And as we start to see that addiction, of course, is an immoral failure, but we've now biomedicalized it, which I think also fails to capture really what addiction truly is, which is a psycho-spiritual ailment, we really see the potential of psychedelics in a role to treat a trauma and addiction. And in the ayahuasca study that we had a chance to coordinate and participate in as a co-researcher, we worked with First Nations on the BC coast. And I've never worked with a population that's had and suffered so much sexual, psychological, and physical abuse through the residential school treatment program in Canada, through really multi-generational abuse. And as a result of that, we had individuals who'd had multiple treatment failures for crack, opiates, crystal meth, and alcohol. And really what I learned through their dialogue and hearing them talk about their own addiction is that what their addiction was a way to treat their inner pain, their inner longing, and really a sense of self-loathing that they developed because it had been imposed upon them, or because they'd embodied the what people had been saying about them for so long. And it was amazing as people went up to use ayahuasca and they were asked what their aspiration was for that particular journey. They didn't say, I want to quit using crack. They didn't say, I want to quit using alcohol. They said, almost to a T, they all said that I'd like to find a way to love myself. I'd like to find some way of self-love and self-understanding. And as a result of the treatment that we did, we ended up getting not only improvements in their substance use, but we had measures that measured hope and empowerment and self-regulation, and we saw statistically significant improvements in all of those measures as well. And so the psychedelic journey, the ability for people to develop, to move from self-loathing to self-love as a form of harm reduction, this, we did this with an extreme population, but I think anyone who's experienced psychedelics, that sense of oneness, that sense of bonding with the rest of the universe and with other individuals around you, is a deep part of the harm reduction experience that, that psychedelic brings. So I think there's a lot of ways to make sure that we all have the best psychedelic experiences possible, but also we need to consider psychedelics themselves for many people as a harm reduction tool in moving past the trauma and addiction in their lives.
Information is the key, and the government is actively suppressing information and putting out misinformation on purpose. I mean, they want it to be out there because it makes it scarier, and the better, as Rick mentioned, the better to deter people, right? To the extent they're thinking about this rationally at all, they're making the calculations. We're willing to sacrifice the interests of current drug users, people who are not listening to the law and are going out using these drugs anyway, for the sake of those who might use drugs if they were legal, right? So anybody who has any sense at all and has considered it at all recognizes that if you ban something, you create a black market, people will end up, you know, swallowing these mystery pills and snorting these mystery powders. They don't know what the hell they're taking. That can't possibly be good, right? If you're lucky, you only get ripped off. You know, if you're not so lucky, you get something that's actually much more dangerous than what you bargained for. They compound that danger of the lack of information, you know, consumer information, consumers don't know what they're getting, by discouraging harm reduction efforts, right? So if you have laws that say you, as the host of this music festival, can be civilly and criminally liable if you're deemed to be, facilitating drug use or drug sales, we can take your property, we can prosecute you, that's pretty scary. And whether whether letting Dance Safe operate at your festival is actually going to do that or not, people are going to err on the side of caution and say, no, why should I take the risk? So you have a possible, you know, semi-solution where people can get a little bit of knowledge about what they're actually taking, just actively, you know, being discouraged by these laws. I think, you know, part of the solution is to provide information. That can be done without changing the law, obviously. And people, you know, Arrowhead does that, various other sites do that. If people want to get accurate information, those are the places they go. They don't go to the mainstream press. They certainly don't go to the government. So it is available, and that's good. That's encouraging. You have these various third-party testing kits, testing services, which is good. But at some point, you have to try to at least ameliorate these perverse effects of the laws, where not only people don't know what they're getting, but you're pushing them to use less known substances, less studied substances, because they're legal or they're quasi-legal, they're cheaper, whatever. And it's like, well, why the hell are you steering people away from LSD, which, as far as we can tell, is completely non-toxic, toward other stuff where you can overdose die? I mean, it's insane. And people think they're getting one and they get the other. And so New Zealand has this fascinating experiment, which I want to learn more about, where they're trying to create a route where you can go through certain kinds of testing and get chemicals approved. Get these new chemicals approved, so there's actually some information about them.
Yeah, I think we have a lot of positive changes. I don't really have anything to add to that. The developments, I guess the one thing I would leave you with is echoing what you were saying, is there's nothing so uncontrolled as a controlled substance. and that same applies to the information available on it. And that has been the case now for the last 50 years, where we've been kind of battling the criminalization of these substances, and that's what psychedelics share in common with all the other drugs mentioned here. Is this perverse attack on them and on users of those substances and very real casualties. Obviously, there's not that many people serving hard time for psychedelics, but there are people that are. there was a period of time during the late 1980s, the DEA decided they were going to go after what they thought was the West Coast cartel for LSD, and so they busted, they went in at undercover dead agents, deadheads at concerts, and they ended up state and federally an estimated 2,500 or so, primarily young males, ended up serving 3 to 5 to 10 to 20 years with almost no chance of parole. That still is 2,500 people serving hard time. And you have the same thing happening today for people being busted at these festivals, stealing. It doesn't take much to qualify for the advanced mandatory minimums. And so there are true casualties from going drug war.
Thank you. I wanted to add something to the harm reduction discussion, which I thought you were going to do, Jer, but then I gave up. So I just want to make a quick plug for our book, Marsha Rosenbaum, which, oh good, you have it?
Oh, I do.
See?
I never show it to anybody.
All right, so in the back of that book, which came out actually in 1994, but it's still relevant, and if you can get it, you can get it. We listed specifically what were then called flight guides, and they were probably predated any harm reduction we know about, apart from needle exchange and methadone, in which we spelled out the flight guide. It's in the back of the book there, and maybe you want to just couple of the and this is. This is before Braves and before any of that. Yes?
What's the title of your book?
Oh, Pursuit of Ecstasy, the MDMA Experience.
In which, summarize what it says on the back. It tells people, it's all about, it comes right from Norman Zimmer, Drug Sensei. Yeah. And it tells people that to make sure that, first off, the drug you're using, you know, is the drug you think you're using, however you do that, MDMA, and that you're in a good headspace, that you're rested, and you're not dealing with any negative kind of emotional challenges, that the setting is very important, to have a quiet setting then, comfortable chairs, water on hand. We put in there little munchy things. I'm not sure why we did that. and not to eat for 3 hours before. And anyway, it was a version of harm reduction. And this one is important, I think. And there was a notion, not so much Debbie's. You only have 10 good trips, but it was.
So don't squander them.
Some place it came that only every 3 months, no more than 3 months. And also discouraged in there was boosters, and anyway, I could go on, but you get
don't
that
get
was,
married for three weeks. Yeah.
That was Timothy Leary. So there was those original ones, and I just wanted to share a quick story. When 20 years ago, when my daughter was maybe a little less than that, my daughter was in high school, and she was precocious and is precocious now. And she and two of her best friends announced to me, I was standing in the kitchen, they were, Mom, what are you doing? We're going to a rave. I thought, they're going to a rave. And I knew that I only had a couple of remarks that I could make, very limited amount of time to make them in. And so my first question was, what's your transportation plan? Okay, they're taking a taxi. Thank God we lived in the city, so that was good. They got that worked out. And I paused for a minute and I said, okay, listen, somebody might be offering you a substance, a drug, at the rave. I want you to know, not a good idea to ingest a substance where you are not absolutely positively sure what it is. However, if you ignore me, which wouldn't have been the first time, I just have one piece of advice. Please don't take more than one. So that was my version of harm reduction. And so good.
Thank you, Mom.
So the question I want to ask, and then I'd like to open it up to have a discussion with all of you who, you know, obviously know something about psychedelics. Thank you, Jim, for that question. Often drug policy reformers get asked, okay, so if you're advising the government, and they might take you seriously, what would you do? I want to just put aside the question of marijuana for right now, because that's the easiest, I think, to recommend to the government. And okay, substances like the opiates are harder, I think, to figure out, you know, what kind of a system we're going to have, what kind of a system we would recommend for the opiates. I am stumped on the question of, if I were advising the government, what would I tell them to do in terms of regulating psychedelics?
Who wants to go first?
I would start with alcoholics. And I would remind the government that in Canada, in the province of Saskatchewan in the 60s, it was no longer an experimental treatment, it was a treatment. Because with hardcore alcoholics, with everything wrong with them you can imagine, and having failed every known treatment, there was a 50% success rate. So I would start there. And as you pointed out very wisely, when I did some work with alcoholics myself in the 60s, and what we were very clear is if you had a transcendent experience, you tended to stop drinking. If you had less than that, you had a hell of an interesting time, which you could talk about at the bar. And since we're doing commercials, the update of their book on how to have a safe and sacred journey is those first two chapters in a Theo guide are actually the first two chapters of my book, which is more current, and has actually all the same advice they gave, which is really wonderful. So there seems to be some generalized advice across substances, across certain settings, and that is the basic education that, again, the government may also find that it is useful not to have, as you do with pharmaceuticals, something in 8-point type that usually says, among the side effects are death, with whatever you buy, but genuine information as part of the packaging of any regulation. And that information, in a sense, it's more like learning how to fly a plane. Everyone in this room has the right to fly a plane. There's no law against it. There is a law against not knowing how to do it. That's a model that we have not really explored with pharmaceuticals.
I want to, before you stop, I want to add to the question, you're advising the government, and the question in there is, who's the gatekeeper?
Yes, I am.
Okay, Rick's the dose doctor.
Well, I think there's two parts. I think, what do you imagine the end state policy is, and then how do we get from here to there? So what I would advise the government is that the first step is medicalization of psychedelics. That there's a lot of people that use psychedelics, particularly young people, that don't even know that MDMA was a therapeutic drug. They just know about it as a party drug. So I think once you get the information out that people can really understand that these drugs have therapeutic uses, that they're used in the treatment of addiction, that the drugs themselves are not bad or good, it's how they're used, it's the relationship, they have a whole range of uses, that we medicalize the drugs. Then what we create is a situation similar, you gave a good example about the airlines. So I think what we have is a place, I've got three teenagers and they're going through getting their driver's licenses. So what they have to do is they have to demonstrate that they can drive when there's somebody in the car with them that knows how to drive, watching them. So I think we create medicalized psychedelics, we create psychedelic clinics, and then we expand them so that the people who are going to these clinics don't necessarily need to be the patients, but that they could be people who are going for personal growth experiences. If they have a personal growth experience that is without major psychotic break, or they understand the power of the drugs, then they get a license to go purchase it on their own and use it for whatever purposes they want. So that you then can take this license away from them if they do something stupid, if they crash their car, or if they, you know, run down screaming down the road or something, taking off all their clothes. You can take their license away, but that adults should have the freedom to use this for whatever purpose. And then we move forward with religious freedom. We eventually say that it doesn't have to be part of a religion. You could have your own personal spiritual growth. I think the harder issue is, what do we do about kids? And
do it with their parents.
Well, yes. So I think that we take a model here from alcohol. How 23 states in the United States have a parental override to the drug, the prohibitions against use of alcohol by minors, if they are given it by their parents. So I think that we have opportunities for young people to experience it either in religious settings or in family settings. It's going to be really hard to legalize it, I think, for underage kids without any kind of intermediary. But once they get a certain age, if their parents have not said they can do it, then they go to one of these clinics, and then they have an experience, and then they can go do it on their own. And they can use it in recreational settings, anything. So I think that's the overall direction, and I think it'll probably take us 30 years or so to get there. 10 years for medicalization, and then maybe another 20 years to phase in all these other kind of expansions.
I think those are all totally well considered. I've had a couple of things to that. I think one of them is low doses. I think that we need to create a low dose alternative so that people can be introduced to these substances in a way that gives them a level of comfort as to what they're getting into. I think that we, the standard street dose of MDMA out there right now may not be the right dose for everyone to start out with, and I think even Rick's studies are really interesting right now. The MAP studies that are suggesting that even low doses of MDMA may be as effective or certainly have an effect at a range that we didn't expect.
Medium doses.
Okay. I think 75. So with MDMA, it'd be 75. So maybe. But if we had things broken down in a 50 milligram doses, as opposed to jumping with 100 milligram doses, or I think that we'd be heading in the right direction. I'd also think that we really need to look at two different divisions here when we're talking about the use of psychedelics, the therapeutic and psychoactive use. And one of them is a controlled setting. Therapeutic uses inherently are going to be a bit more controlled. You're going to have more face-to-face interaction. There'll be someone else in the room. And we need to worry about those a little bit less. I think that uncontrolled settings for psychoactive settings, which absolutely should be allowed and can be incredibly beneficial, becomes more challenging. But I did something interesting this summer. Well, not interesting. I got my boat license in Canada. Now, to get a boat license in Canada to drive a recreational craft, it turns out, is an online course. And the online course is divided up into 6 segments. Now, they're really smart in the way they design this. Each segment's about 90 minutes to 2 hours long, and it's divided up into 3-minute chunks. You have to either read or listen to an audio recording that gives you a 3-minute piece of information. And every 3 minutes, you have to click it, or else it doesn't go forward. So I thought I'd turn this 2-hour chunk on, walk away, do some cooking, and then, you know, read the booklet and come in and do the test. You can't. You have to go back every 3 minutes and click it. So inevitably, I found myself actually reading or listening to what the instructions were and finding out about boat safety. Now, at the end of all of these things, you do a test for the different chunks. Oh, and by the way, you can only do one chunk a day. So you actually have to do 6 days to learn this. You can't just do 12 hours in a row and get your boat license. So you have to plan, you have to be present, and you have to pass the test. And if we're looking at a way to force education cheaply on a mass level, I just couldn't think of a more brilliant way to do it than this way that forces people to click through. That's not a matter of just reading a book, memorizing three answers, and going in and doing a test. And I think that maybe that gives us one of the directions that we can head at and formulate when we're talking about this kind of education.
So let me rephrase this. I still want to know what you're advising the government.
Right. Low doses.
Okay, Jerry.
And online testing.
Let me just comment
on that.
Okay. And then I'll go to Jerry. Low doses. I got one more question to all of you. How many have used what are called microdoses, which is like a fifth to a tenth of a dose? Oh, goody. Because that's what I'm doing my research on, is what is the value and use of microdoses? Any of you wish to write me at jfadiman at gmail, I will not give you credit, I promise. But that's what we're exploring, is a lot of the low-dose work, which is something else to tell the government, which is there is something very important about doses with psychedelics, which is not true of many pharmaceuticals, which is different effects at different levels. And that's an educational difference, first for the government, second for us.
Okay, Jerome, you're talking to
I think, you know, trying to, I would recommend that the government get out of the way of interfering with a lot of these harm reduction efforts. I mean, and you could go back, like, in the book, those were not just indigenous kind of attempts at producing flight guides to educate new users. But by that time, the time we published, there was a lot of great harm reduction information that was coming out of Europe and Australia that was sanctioned by government entities or providing funding. And so even though that is changed at different points of time, I think we have a lot to learn from other countries. With the New Zealand laws for the new synthetics and how to deal with those in a different way than our usual failed approach. And anything that encourages honest drug education. And that could be at concert scenes, but that also could be in schools. And I have to be thinking about the boat license.
Canadian boat licensor.
We don't even have them here.
Very exciting. First of all, I want to emphasize, and I think we all do agree on this point, but I want to emphasize that ultimately I don't want the government to be asking you what's your reason and deciding whether it's good enough.
Yeah, right.
That people might dismiss it as frivolous if you want to use LSD because it's fun, but fun is important. You know, it's one of the best parts of life is fun. You know, and so I would rather there not be an FDA at all. But if there's going to be an FDA, I would like it to be possible to go to them and say, I've got a drug that I'd like you to approve, and they say, what's the application? And you say, fun. Specifically, fun at parties, or fun when you're going out for a hike in the woods, or whatever. And, you know, you can have very, very targeted compounds. I'm not a big fan of regulation. I think that what Rick was describing. Testing people, different dealers' drugs, and letting people know about them is starting to simulate the effects of what we call a free market or competition, where brands come, people have to build brand reputation. If you have a legal market, you can do this, right? So the main reason, we've talked about this before, but the main reason, you know, when you go into a liquor store and you buy something and it says it's 25 proof, that it doesn't turn out to be 50 proof, ever, pretty much, right? It's not because, the government tells them not to do that, you know. Ultimately, of course, the government is there as a backstop, and if you commit fraud, you can get in trouble and so on. The main reason is that you piss off your customers if you do that kind of thing, right? If you are, you know, if you expect to be around for a while, you're not a fly-by-night operator, you're a part of a legal system, you're competing with other people, you want to give people honest information, you want them to be able to provide the quality of your product, you want to improve your product, you want to come up with new compounds that do specifically targeted things, and you don't have to take 8 or 10 hours out of your, you know, plan to this big block of time where it's short acting, where it does exactly what it does. There's all kinds of potential if you open it up and allow there to be competition. I think that really is the crucial part of it. You do need to have a backstop in the sense that some people have a legal remedy if they're ripped off, right? If somebody commits fraud, for sure you need that. But in terms of prescribing
I'm not a big fan of licensing, licensing users, any of that. I mean, Rick, if Rick assures me that in 30 years it'll be looser, I don't know. So I want to wait 30 years. You know, I don't think the government needs to say exactly what doses there should be. There will be a variety of doses available. There will be appropriate warnings. If somebody wants to sell a mystery capsule and say, I don't know what the hell's in this, and people want to try that, they should have, you know, the freedom to do that, realizing that they have no idea what the hell's in it. Most people, I think, would rather go with a product where it's labeled and tells you exactly what's in it and something about the research, about what it does, that kind of thing. So that's what I think is that's the exciting prospect to me. Of legalization is getting government out of the way, allowing the market to work, allowing people to compete for customers. And I think people given information, they're not always going to make the right choices. Sometimes they're going to make stupid choices, for sure. But they're going to make better choices overall than they would where they're completely, or not completely in the dark, but they're largely in the dark, and where people are not accountable, where, you know, the people selling the drugs are not accountable, people making them are not accountable.
Okay, so we have 15 minutes, and is this the only mic in the room? This is the only mic.
There were two in the last, there were like three in the last session.
So here's the thing. You got 30 seconds to pose a question or make a quick statement, but you don't have more than that. So, because there's a lot of people who want, you all have a minute to give an answer. Just to try and include.
All right,
here we go.
I'm not sure how well the answer could be constrained to that time limit, but I'll try and be quick.
Okay.
Going back to the analogy you made about book burning, the cognitive freedoms granted by psychedelic research and the threat to institutionalized power, as we've seen by the criminalization of the substance, I'm just curious as to your success stories and the walls you've come up against in terms of gaining funding to substances that could eventually, due to cross-generational global usage, actually cause the crumbling of very entrenched systemic power. So I'm just interested to hear your stories on that.
Perfect timing.
Okay. Let us come to you.
I don't want to waste any time. The study that we did on ayahuasca and addiction was really remarkable, and it was really studying the way that a doctor named Gabor Mate was using ayahuasca as part of a stress and addiction retreat. About 2 weeks before, a documentary on Nature Things, which is a big documentary producer in Canada, ran a movie called Jungle Medicine that really focused on Dr. Mate's experiences with ayahuasca. He got a letter of warning from Health Canada telling him to cease and desist working with ayahuasca, or else they were going to basically turn him over. Well, not basically, it said in the letter, turn him over to the RCMP and let them deal with him. And so, unfortunately, despite the amazing findings that we've seen in our study and the amazing outcomes, he's had to stop doing these retreats in Canada, and therefore the people who could benefit the most from them are no longer have access, at least within this setting, to that access. So that's not a way to come across it, but that is one of the ways that the government's pushed back on this kind of work and research.
I just want to say there's something sort of encoded in what you said that I think is sort of this mythology of the 60s that I think really isn't true anymore. This idea that somehow or other psychedelics are inherently corrosive of established authority, and that if we let loads of people do it, we're going to have the collapse of structures. And, you know, I don't think that's really true. And I think it's, in a way, part of our work to show that we can have these experiences and we can be productive members of our society. We can be reformers, but it's not the case that psychedelics let loose in any culture will inherently cause it all to collapse. And so I think it's incumbent upon us to, in a way, show that that's not the case.
Yeah, I think actually that idea, while for the people who agree with whatever the ideas are that it's supposed to unleash, think it's great, it can be very threatening to other people. And if you try to figure out what happened with marijuana, like why was this banned for so long, it's because it had all of this cultural baggage. Right, and it came with an ideology. What, you know, it's kind of an absurd notion in retrospect, but it's like once you smoke pot, you have to have a certain attitude toward capitalism and the establishment. It's like total nonsense. It's not true. I mean, it may give you a sort of interesting, different perspective on things, but you're not going to come out to be reliably to be one political persuasion or another. And we shouldn't, even in a positive way, you know, suggest that that's the truth, because that may actually makes it more threatening. And it also feeds into the sort of deterministic idea that you take a drug, it has a, you know, reliable, predictable effect every time, and the mechanistic kind of way.
Okay. I want to just say, Rick, you've been on mainstream TV on this stuff. I mean, it just nobody's chuckling or laughing or anything. I mean, they're starting to really take this stuff seriously, your research on psychedelics, particularly with the vets.
Well, I'd say the reason I'm wearing a suit is to get across that same message.
The more unconventional you are, the more conventional you have to look.
Yeah. You can wear a suit and still wear cannabis socks. Mary Garcia died.
I'm going to assume if you can share your voice, then I don't think I need to do this.
You talked about low doses. I was wondering what you thought about Larry's statement about you haven't really done LSD until you've done at least 1,000 mics or more.
Whoa.
Yeah, and Terrence McKenna has something even worse. Yeah, and you don't know anything about cars unless you've done 150 miles an hour, okay? Which is, excess is excessive. Microdoses are little. They're just different realms.
And I'd add to that that I think that there are clearly some doses where you need a threshold dose. I mean, with ayahuasca, that may be the case, although I've seen some experiences where people have ingested ayahuasca, thrown up right away, and still journeyed. So I think that there's no biological reason they would have, but they still have. You know, I love Marsha's advice about if you're going to take something, only take one. I have another friend who used to live by the advice, when in doubt, double the dose. So I think that the reason I recommend low doses is for people to have an initial experience that doesn't turn them off from these things. Because if that initial experience is negative, because you have no dose control, and dose isn't the only thing that dictates positive or negative, but certainly it can be one of the aspects of it, then we have more chance of having people have positive experiences with these substances, learning about them, and being able to increase the dose if they want to later on down the road.
Where can I find a discussion of dosage levels?
Not here.
But I did want to mention, though, I mean, especially something like LSD, the first dose, first session, and having an overwhelming dose, which may not be that much relative to your experience later on, because it's so totally new. But I think I just wanted to mention one of the major harm reduction accomplishments over the last 20 years has not been done, obviously, has not been done by the government, but by distributors of LSD, manufacturers, because almost all LSD on the street for the last 20 years has been consistently kind of for the most part, a very low, consistent dosage. People can pretend like they're doing, 60 megadoses of taking 3 or 4 of these, but it still pales in comparison to, say, some of Owsley's LSD or something and taking only one. But it's done wonders in terms of reducing and keeping it low, the number of emergency room admission. Bad trips on LSD went way down, starting in somewhere around in the early 70s, and stayed down. And a lot of that was the government, a lot of so-called experts, thought it was just because not as many people were doing LSD. Wrong. More and more people were doing LSD. They were just doing predictably lower doses and not getting surprised. And less people were probably getting it in the punch bowl or something, which is the word, one of the major predictors of a bad trip is not even knowing you're taking it in the first place.
Okay, right here.
I have a question about MDMA dosage, specifically when it comes to therapeutic trials. I'm not sure whether or not, I think I heard this from some researcher, I can't remember the researcher or the study, but I heard on some conference I went to that some clients who were getting the therapy, when they took too low of a dose of MDMA, they actually became more anxious, and some people dropped out of the study because the dose was too low. Is this true?
Yes. So what we're trying to do is figure out how to do double-blind studies. We're using dose response. So our current study in veterans has three different groups, 30 milligrams, 75 milligrams, and 125 milligrams. When we did the first study, we had an inactive placebo. And so when people just got the therapy by themselves without any drug, they had 20 points drop on this measure of PTSD symptoms. When we added 25 milligrams in the Swiss study, they actually got a little bit worse. And in the US study, the 30 milligrams, they're only getting a very slight gain.
So there's a way where you get activated and you're in a position to talk about the trauma, but you don't have the emotional support, the fear reduction that helps you move through it. And what we're finding, to our surprise, is that the 75 milligram group is actually doing better than the 125 milligram group. And it may be that there's a whole different model of how the healing actually happens, that a lot of the stuff that the waves of pleasure, things like that, may actually be somewhat distracting from going through the work through your trauma. But I will say that we use a measure called post-traumatic growth inventory. So people who are traumatized, who overcome it, have often a new sense of what they're going to, new sense of purpose, new appreciation for life. So the higher dose people, the only measure that they did better on than the medium was this post-traumatic growth inventory. So it's not directly related to the PTSD symptom. But I will say, from an experimental point of view, it's exactly what we want to have happen. That the people who get the lower dose, stuff still happens. They confuse it sometimes with the higher dose, but they don't seem to have a therapeutic effect. So it's easier for us to show a difference between the full dose or the medium dose and the low dose.
So I want to just interject here. I think this is a very interesting discussion of dosing, and I think it's a whole session worth of dosing, and I want to just bring up, when we have this, I mean, it's all very nice to talk about LSD dose and how much and even MDMA, but I would pose a question which you don't need to answer now, but how do you do that with mushrooms? And the other question is, edible cannabis, the dose of that can produce a psychedelic experience, and this is kind of an unknown. So does anyone have a question that's not about dose?
My name is Brian Gilbert. I just joined DanceSafe's board of directors.
Woo! Go DanceSafe! I love DanceSafe's folks here.
So I had a question about psychedelic harm reduction. So even though we've experienced a really resurgence positive attention on harm reduction efforts at live music events in the past few months since Electric Zoo, culminating in our experience at Tomorrow World recently a few weeks ago, what would you say is sort of the biggest policy barrier towards doing some of the more controversial aspects of our work, like you alluded to with Boom Festival's really extensive drug checking and adulterant screening programs, because that's the one aspect of our work that has been looked down upon still, and still has not been something we've been able to conduct. So like policy-wise, what advice would you give to us working on the front lines trying to change that, and how would you suggest go about doing so that we can sort of do more of the controversial aspects that actually have a much bigger impact on keeping people safe?
Forfeiture reform? What else? Basically, removing the forfeiture threat and the threat of criminal prosecution, sort of vicarious liability, that either civil or criminal liability, that either the host, the venue owner has, or that the organizers of the festival have under the law. If they don't have to worry about that so much, then they're not going to be so nervous about that kind of harm reduction. That's really the source of it. So.
It's funny because we do this inherently with alcohol. A bar will serve alcohol and non-alcoholic drinks, and you don't have the police or the government saying, well, if you serve non-alcoholic drinks, it means you must know someone's going to crash on the way home. It's a risk. Therefore, we're going to take away your bar. So it's amazing that we have a reverse argument when it comes to psychedelics, that because someone's got a chill-out room, someone's got drug testing, you're trying to prevent harms, but the admission that drug use may be taking place is enough to...
In fact, with alcohol, there's a whole body of law developed in response to that risk. You can be held liable if you keep serving somebody who's visibly intoxicated, stumbling around, and you have the right to refuse them a drink, and there's, whole theories of civil liability built around that, but it's designed to encourage responsibility, not to discourage.
Thank you. And then one last question, the woman in the back. Yes.
I'm Rachel, I'm a chapter leader at New Paltz, Institute for Drug Policy. I was just wondering, what is the current research on medical applications of psychedelic drugs? Like, what's the research being done now? What are the recent findings? You were talking about ayahuasca before. I haven't actually heard about that, but I want to hear, what are the other findings?
Sure.
Right. Well, there's three basic lines of research that are taking place for positive applications. Right. So one line of research is MDMA for post-traumatic stress disorder in people who are chronic treatment resistant. There's another line of research in people who are anxious about dying, working mostly with psilocybin, and we did our first study in over 40 years with LSD was in Switzerland for people who were anxious about dying. And then the third area of research is psychedelics in the treatment of substance abuse. And I think the way in which we're going to move through the FDA, it's most likely going to be either PTSD or psilocybin for end of life, or end of life that makes it through first. Because again, the addicts are the other, but it's really useful to do research with psychedelics in the treatment of addiction, because it gets across the idea that these are, it's how the drugs are used, that a drug of abuse is helping people with drug abuse problems. I was just contacted by a group in Germany. They wanted to do work with couples therapy with MDMA. That's not happening yet at all. And the reason is because a difficult relationship is not a disease. So it might feel like that at different times, but it's not a route for us to expand policy and expand legal opportunities for it. So, and then the fourth general area that's going on is just neuroscience research, which is incredible, trying to figure out how the brain works and what psychedelics do. So I think over time, you know, the uses will expand. We just got an approval for a study at Harvard UCLA for adults with on the autism spectrum who have social anxiety. So that study will start soon in LA.
What about?
And we're talking about OCD. There's some people that are interested in helping us support a study with MDMA for people with OCD. There's a whole range of potential uses, but they're really clustering PTSD, end of life, and treatment of addiction right now.
What about the quality of life studies that work like at Johns Hopkins?
Quality of life?
Okay. So that's more in terms of the spiritual experience.
Yeah.
Yeah, there's going to be a really interesting study that's going to be done in Switzerland with lifelong Zen meditators who are brain scanned at the University of Zurich before and after a 10-day meditation retreat during which they get psilocybin during the retreat, and then their measures of compassion, altruism, other things that are supposed to flow from the mystical experience, and then the quality of their enhanced meditation, if it enhances in any way their meditation. So yeah, that's another area that is happening now, where, and what's so exciting is science and religion really are starting to come together in a lot of these studies.
And then, in a sense, the cluster headaches were discovered not in any laboratory, but because somebody found that LSD cured their cluster headache or prevented a series. And out of that, research eventually came. That's part of the kind of microdosing that I'm talking about. I have a list of conditions that people have reported to me have either overcome with microdosing or with large dosing, which is everything Rick has mentioned, plus a number of other conditions. And that's how we're finding out. It's a lot easier to do research, and all of you know this, if it already works.
I just add that the government and current prohibition dictates a lot of the research direction. There's a reason that a lot of the psychedelic research is being looked at with end of life study. It's because you suddenly remove the risk of addiction, quote unquote, or the risks of to physical health from long term use. In other words, you could say to the government, it doesn't matter; these people are dying already. So not only is it beneficial, but it's easier to get through the ethics approval. And so I think what Rick has described is really the difference between the sociological research that's going on quality of life issues, which as you say isn't a disease, but it's an important aspect that we all know psychedelics impact, and the biomedical aspect where you're much more restricted in the research you can do.
So I want to thank all of you for coming. I want to thank our panel, great panel.